What food made you think how the frick did our ancestors found out this was edible? Acorns. How hungry one must be to figure out to pound them to powder and leach out the tannins. Three times. Came here to say that. At Yosemite, I saw a demonstration of how the locals leached acorns. The process is days long, with many many steps. Also, how the hell did Stone Age man discover nixtamalization of corn? If you don't do it, and you rely on corn as a primary food, you get a nasty deficiency disease, pellagra. The cassava. However, cassava is poisonous unless it is peeled and thoroughly cooked. If it is eaten raw or prepared incorrectly, one of its chemical constituents will be attacked by digestive enzymes and give off the deadly poison cyanide. As little as 2 cassava roots can contain a fatal dose. Poke salad. The pokeberry / pokeweed plant that grows in the southern US has edible leaves. Sort of. If you eat them raw, they contain a neurotoxin that will make you extremely sick or more likely kill you. If you cook them, the toxin will still kill you. If you boil them, the toxin will still kill you. So basically someone died after eating this stuff and their friends went, well, maybe if we boil it one more time died, and someone else went, third time's the charm. However, if you boil them, discard the water, boil again, discard the water, then boil one last time and discard the water again, the leftover cooked plant is sort of edible. To add to the fun, you also have to pick the right part of it. You need to pick the young shoots before they have any red in the stems, or the boiling just won't cut it. Hakal. Usually poisonous, unless prepared thus. The traditional method is by gutting and beheading a Greenland or sleeper shark and placing it in a shallow hole dug in gravelly sand, with the now cleaned cavity resting on a small mound of sand. The shark is then covered with sand and gravel, and stones are placed on top of the sand in order to press the shark. In this way the fluids are pressed out of the body. The shark ferments in this fashion for 6 to 12 weeks depending on the season. Following this curing period, the shark is then cut into strips and hung to dry for several months. During this drying period a brown crust will develop, which is removed prior to cutting the shark into small pieces and serving. Ooh, I've tried this. It's not even that good. It tastes like blue cheese but moodier and fishier. It also tastes and smells like ammonia, coming from the fact that a shark's bladder closes up when it dies. Castoreum. Sweet tasting exudation that comes from glands near a beaver's asshole. Damn, this beaver ass smells great. Wonder what it tastes like? Well, that one's pretty easy to guess. Native Americans or perhaps European fur trappers cooked and ate different parts of the beaver. The one day, one of them happened to get this weird sweet taste, and started experimenting by eating different bits one at a time until they pinpointed the location. Bada bing, bada boom, bit of a big beaver butt bite. Puffer fish. Only a small part of the fish is edible and the rest is deadly poisonous. So how did they find out which bit was edible? Trial and error. The fruit of the gimpy plant. It is also known as the suicide plant because its sting is so painful that there have been reports of people and animals killing themselves to escape the pain, which can last for days or even years. The sting is delivered by tiny hairs that cover the whole plant, yet someone was able to discover that if you painstakingly remove each hair from the fruit, it is edible. Cashews. First, they come from a drupe that grows out of a false fruit called the cashew apple. So right off the bat, you'd never guess that it would be the part you'd eat. Cashew apples look kind of like a cross between an apple and a red bell pepper, just with a big, ugly dark brownish cashew in place of a stem. Second, the shells of cashew drupes contain a substance that causes rashes and chemical burns on skin. So before you can even think of eating a cashew seed, which is what cashew nuts actually are, it has to go through a multi-step steaming and roasting process, just to totally burn off all the irritants. Wait, but I buy raw cashews all the time. Lyfish. Lutefisk. Don't get me wrong, I love the stuff, but man. First you go get a fish. Then you let it hang on a stick for months to dry out. Then you put it in water for a couple days. Then you put it in water with lye for another couple days. Then you put it in pure water again, and then you cook it and eat it. My husband's Norwegian immigrant father looks forward to Christmas season and readily available lutefisk like children anticipate Santa Claus. Being fed, and pretending to like, lutefisk was part of my initiation into the family. After 3 bites, my future husband leaned over and whispered, "You can stop, None of us eat that garbage except him. And Viking descendants and their marginally edible fermented preserved foodstuffs. See also, Hakal. Some mushrooms that require special preparation. Eat it raw or cook it like most other shrooms and you end up dead. Boil it 3 to 5 times however, and it's fine. Edit, an example of a mushroom requiring this procedure is Gyromitra esculenta. Also my most upvoted comment is now about mushrooms, also RIP my inbox. Okay, so boiling it once didn't work, and boiling it twice didn't work. Once you realize how rare food really is in the wild for every 365 days, it makes a lot more sense. Starvation and famine was a regular event for most of human history. Lose your own stash of food for a couple days and you'll eat all sorts of things. I can't remember the exact quote, but in some Michael Pollan documentary or book he says something to the effect that sugar, salt and fat occur extremely rarely in nature. So our bodies are programmed to want as much of those things as we can get. In our modern world where you have pretty much instant access to all of those things, boom, obesity epidemic. Sea urchin. I was going to post this. I had it on sashimi before, not bad, but not good either. Regardless, that shit looks deadly when you see it in the water. Artichoke. Hum, that purple thistle looks good. It's prickly and completely inedible. Hum. Oysters. Someone looked at that snotty looking thing from a shell and thought, yeah, I'm gonna put that in my mouth. Hum. Looks just like jellified grey sneezing matter from inside a seashell. Down to taste salty. Down it goes. Ugh, get me some lemon. Dot. Chili peppers. Like imagine finding this pepper, taking a bite, and then feeling your entire mouth feel like it is on fire. Then you decide it's actually really good though and start including it into dishes to add spice. Scrolled way too far down to find this. Consider that hot peppers fail every single edibility test. It irritates the skin, mouth, and bowels. By any survival guide's methods, you should not eat this thing. But we ate that shit anyway, probably on a dare. Lobsters. Well, this looks horrifying. I think I'll taste it. Dot. Land arthropods equals creepy and disgusting. Nopales, a kind of cactus, and its fruit have been a staple in Mexico for millennia. I've always wondered what went through our ancestors' heads. That plant and its fruit is covered in thorns. I bet they're delicious. Probably I've been in this fucking desert for 2 fucking weeks. And I'm out of fucking food and god's fucking damn it, there's a lot of needles I've got to pluck out of these death apples. Yogurt and cheese. It's like first of all they start drinking cow juice from cow titties. Then they save some for later. It goes off. Voila cheese. Not even just that. Cheese needs RNA from an animal's stomach to turn into cheese. They were storing milk or curds or something in a nasty ass, improperly cured goat stomach or something and then decided to eat it when it turned solid. Cheese. Damn, the milk turned hard and stinks of teenage sneakers. Dot. Somehow compelled to taste the thing. Coffee. Can't eat the beans as is, gotta roast them first. Whoops, not yet, gotta grind them. Hum, not quite right yet, let's pour water over them and drink the water. Let's try using hot water. Perfect. I'm so glad you asked. The legend foes that an Ethiopian goat farmer observed his goats acting energetically after eating the cherries off of a coffee tree, the original Arabica plant. He tried it and the caffeine took effect. At first it was eaten. I don't recall if they cooked the beans first or just ate them straight from the cherry. Over time, as we do, we experimented. They were medicinal for a time. Before it was coffee as we know it today, the roasted, ground beans were consumed with the hot water used to make it coffee, and to this day some still drink it that way as Turkish coffee. We learned how to separate the grounds from the water and eventually how to create a stronger coffee drink using pressure, espresso. Wish I could remember when and where the very first coffee house and coffee cart came into existence, but it's not where one might assume. Bread. Like how did someone put all the ingredients together to make the bread? I think about it all the time. Truffles. If the pigs are eating it, it must be fucking delicious. Kazumazu. It's cheese with live maggots living in ot. Mag and cheese. Not exactly a food, but cocaine. I saw a show going through the process of making it. All I can think is, How did someone come up with the idea of mix stuff like gasoline and battery acid together and then dry it up to powder they could sniff? How? That last part is chemistry. The fact that the raw plant has stimulant slash feel good properties was known for long time. Durian. It's super spiky, it seems like it'd be tough to open, though I'm not 100% sure, and apparently it smells rank. I thought about this too, but animals like orangutans love them, human probably saw that and tried some. Not even ancestors, how did drinks like Guinness or Coke become a thing? Bro, try this no, that drink is black. Yeah, good call. Vegemite is the same principle, but in that case it was literally created as a prank from brewery waste products, but then the pranky went it's not bad too. Actually, I think I just answered the question. They did it on accident or were tricked slash goaded into trying it, they did. And when it didn't kill them, the consumable caught on. I've had the same thought about any booze that is aged, like scotch. You can imagine the scene, some very thirsty ancient Scots come across a barrel in a cave, a barrel everyone had forgotten about. Let's see if it is still any good. Imagine the wide-eyed looks exchanged between the first tasters of that barrel. Blue cheese. Yes. This. Like who looked at a piece of moldy cheese and was like this is some seriously gummy st. Fugu, like how did they find out that only a specific part of a blowfish wasn't poisonous when correctly cut? Chocolate. Pokeweed. People still eat poke salad today, and you have to boil the pokeweed 3 times to make it not be poisonous. Who watched their fellow tribesmen die after boiling it twice and thought maybe 3 times will do it? Heart of palm. Uck, I'm bored. I'm gonna eat this tree now. Honey. When something is guarded by swarms of easily pissed off insects with poisoned astarts, you would think that would be enough of a deterrent that nobody would fuck with it. Wouldn't people have seen bears going after it? Rice, who looked at a piece of thick grass and thought, yeah, I'll dry it out, bash it about then polish it and boil it just before it turns into a sloppy mess. And risotto, maybe instead of taking it out before it becomes a sloppy mess, let's take it out after. Lobster. Let's eat this spider from the sea. I think about it every time I see a lobster. It's the perfect example of food that we learned we could eat out of necessity. Nobody pulled a lobster out of the water and thought, ooh, that looks tasty. It had to be more like I gotta try to find a way to bust this fucker open and try to eat it so I don't die. Snails. Our ancestors must have been friggin' starving. Snails are actually considered to be the first, of one of the first, domesticated species. They're pretty easy to keep, not like they can really escape. Twice boiled greens. Like who watched someone die and went, just try it again. Caviar, I imagine them say yum fish eggs and eating them, and then selling that to rich people. Noodles. Like who thought of swinging the dough to make em stringy? Maple syrup. Let's poke a hole in this here tree, collect the sap, boil it for 3 days and see what happens. Most foods came about from happy accidents. You might have accidentally left something out, it ferments, and you eat it because you have nothing else. Voila, there's bread. I think people also underestimate how much the human body is conditioned to tell us when something is edible. All our senses are designed to communicate if we can eat something. First, does it look right? Most fruit looks great, we know what a good fruit looks like. Next is smell. Does it smell right? A fruit might look good, but smell rotten, and that is our body telling us not to eat it. Finally, we have taste. Does it taste really bad? If it tastes bad, good chances it is bad for you. There is also the matter that many foods you can consume in small quantities and they will make you mildly sick, then big quantities will make you very sick. Our ancestors probably tested a few things, and if they made you throw up, you knew not to eat those anymore. Think about it, though. Most animals don't have anything but instinct, and they still know what to eat or not eat. Even if nobody told you to not eat a maggoty lamb shank, you probably would avoid it just because of your instincts. Humans are still animals, and we can figure things out based off instincts. There are a few outliers to these situations, but for the most part I think we figured out most of our diet these ways.